Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Today I want to talk about electronics engineers and hardware engineering in general. When I say hardware, I mean electronics. So those are my thoughts based on 25 years of experience in the field. I worked as an employee, as a contractor, and I founded two companies. So I would like to share my experiences, and maybe it will help someone to make a good career choice. So let's get started. So first, let's define what is a hardware engineer. So it's somebody who has formal education in electronics. So what do I mean by that? So is the science part of engineering, which it's probably 80% physics and the rest is math. And then it's the practical side where you learn how to approach a problem and how to design different things, and you understand how different things are working. Now, this field has become very, very, has growing out of proportions in the past, let's say, 30 years or more. And it has become a very, very complex thing. So it's getting more and more difficult to teach electronics because of the complexity and because of so many things happening in the in this field. So now that we know what do we mean by electronic engineer, somebody who went to college and he has a, let's say, a bachelor degree or a master degree or even a PhD. So what are the types of engineers, hardware engineers out there? I think there are three major types. The first type is design engineer. And I think this is one of the most important one because it's the most complex one. So design engineer is usually somebody who can create things. And when I say create things, from the idea to the implementation. Now, it could be, it has many subdomains. For example, you can be a product designer where you need to understand pretty much everything and all the implications in the product. Depending on the complexity of the product, this could be a major job. You could be a PCB designer where you know exactly how to design PCBs and you're probably not great at other things, or maybe you are. You can be a very, very good analog designer where you understand, you know, amplifiers and, I don't know, oscillators and all that great stuff. You could be a digital designer where you understand how to make digital circuitry and how do they interact and all the protocols and different stuff. So it's very, very complex, not to mention that it has another side when you get into microcontrollers where you need to know a little bit of programming and to understand a bit of low-level programming and how a computer works. So it's kind of sliding into computer engineering a little bit. But a design engineer is somebody who creates things from the idea to the end product. Now, they are perceived as all-rounders. They know many things, some of them, obviously not everybody. But there is a danger that they are perceived as a jack of all trades and master of nothing because of that. And we'll talk about that later. Where do they fit in different? Where do they fit in the employment? Now, the second type of engineer is the manufacturing engineer. The manufacturing engineer are the guys which they don't invent things, they don't create things, they keep things moving, which are a very, very important part of our society. So there are those guys which they maintain machineries, they repair machineries, they take care of the day-to-day production. So imagine a semiconductor company where they have so many machineries and so many tools and so many, and they need to work flawlessly. Or, I don't know, a bread factory, let's say, as an example. There are so many things there which they need to work in sync, in perfect sync, to actually make bread. Now, the third category, it's one which I called others. They are necessary for the society But they are usually engineers which they took a different path. They took the easy way out, to be, that's my opinion, my personal opinion. I hope I'm not going to hurt anyone's feeling. But they usually go into technical marketing, so less engineering stuff. They are people which they work in marketing, which they understand a little bit how things are working, how products are working. Then they could be like compliance engineers, which are basically taking care of all the paperwork when they products they need to be compliant with different standards, and they learn those standards and they know how to deal with those standards. Then there are planning engineers, which they are in charge of, you know, buying materials, making sure the production runs smoothly, and they're more like they're more into paperwork and more into, you know, they use different tools. They buy materials. Some of them they become they work in purchasing. Again, another important part of the business. And some others they become managers or product sorry, not product project managers, right? Project managers. They keep one eye on the things, making sure that everything runs smoothly. Everybody has what he needs to perform his job. And I said some of them they become managers. Again, it's an easy way out. You have different type of responsibility. You work more with people, less. You don't work with transistors and multiplexers. You work with people. So those other engineers, I'm not saying that they are useless. I'm saying that they are different type of engineers. They are required for running the business. But look, it's another category. Okay. Now, let's talk about how this fits with the employment. So, as an electronic engineer, you have different career paths, right? One being you are finishing your education, your formal education, and you know how to do stuff, and the company wants to hire you for your skills. So, you need to remember you are actually selling skills. This is what the companies are after. They're not after you as a person, they're after your skills. They want, if you have the skills they require to for them to get to the, you know, to the finish line, they need you. So you need to make sure you apply for a job where your skills are actually put to work, which means in turn that you need to develop skills. Otherwise, this is not going to work. It's all about skills here and about your capacity to learn more skills on top of what you have. Electronic engineering is something where you need to learn continuously every single day. You need to learn. Sometimes you need to train yourself. Sometimes your employer is going to train in different fields that he feel that you require improvement. But the electronics industry, it's flying towards the future. You need to keep up with the future. Okay, so first choice, you are becoming employed by a company, large, big, doesn't matter, for your skills. Just keep this in mind. Now, always have a plan. So if you feel you get stuck there, make a move, make a lateral move, go to some other employer, and you might get stuck in good places where salary is good, but you become very, very narrow specialized. You work for a company which is using some weird tools. You learn the tools inside out, and then when you after 5 years you want to make a move and you realize that nobody else is actually using those tools. So make sure you know what you are learning and what you learn is actually what you want and is useful for your career path. Now, the second choice is to freelance. So become a freelancer. You have to be careful with freelancing because it's risky. It's risky business. So I'm not saying not to do it because it's risky, because it could be very, very rewarding. I did this, it worked for me, but I know many people it didn't work for them. So freelancing has different flavors. One being you make a startup and you build your own product and you try to market that. and sell that and all that. Now, again, if you have many skills, I mean, you know how to design, how to manufacture, how to test and all that, you may save a lot of money at the beginning because you can multiplex those jobs and you can hire people later. So it's a good start. Now, you may go into freelancing as a designer. So you become a contractor for a large company or for a company, let's say, not large. So that's another good thing to do, but you will always be chasing jobs and you need to make sure those customers are happy. And I mean, in general, you need to make sure the customers are happy, but it's not that easy as it sounds. People think, oh yeah, though, they are paying me a daily fee, which is quite high, but no, you need to pay tax. You have your own expenses with tools and training and office or whatever else you have. So again, you need to make sure you know what you're doing. Usually people, they become freelancers in consultancy because this is more like consultancy later in the career where they know more and they understand how things work and they build a little bit of confidence. I mean, the customers, they already know them because they were former employees or and they the trust is already built. Okay, so you can work for your own or you can be employed, doesn't matter. What really matters is if you like it. If you don't like it, it's going to be a pain. It's going to be a painful job. It's if you're just after the money and you don't like it, you're not going to succeed. That's it. Now, different types of people which they get into this. Now, there are, I can see I can probably make two or three types. One is the hobbyist, right? The guy who started from 10 years old building stuff and breaking things apart, and he learned things and then he went into formal education and he basically during the formal education he discovered, oh, that's why that thing which I built, I don't know, 10 years ago didn't work because of this, or oh, that's why it worked and I didn't realize why it worked. So it's good to build a little bit of practical skills before going into formal education and then put that, you know, the theory on top of that, and of course you want to continue. Those are the guys which are probably they have a, like a jump start in their career because they learned many things before when they were very relaxed and it was joyful to learn. They were not under pressure to learn things. Then the second type is the technician who became an engineer. So there were guys which they work as you know, technicians in different jobs and their boss or even on their own, they say, oh yes, let's progress on this, and they went to university or the college and they continue and they become engineers. Those are the guys which they usually they become very good production engineers because they understand the practical side of things. They are not into too much into theory. They learn the theory as a bare minimum to get a degree, but they are very good production engineers or maintenance engineers, or some of them they become good design engineers as well. I mean, I've seen very good engineers which they are coming from the technical background as technicians. Now, probably the third one is that they had absolutely no connection with electronics before they went to formal education in electronics, and they're usually people which are good at maths or good at physics, and they learn electronics and they become very good at electronics. They usually they slide into teaching, which is not a bad thing, or they go towards science side of the electronics, so in a research lab or I don't know, in a very large semiconductor company where they're in charge of, you know, materials and, you know, debugging very weird stuff. So I had colleagues which are very good at this in university, and they become very good engineers into those fields. They're not so good with the practical stuff. But they're very good at explaining things and very good of understanding different phenomena. But yeah, that I think this is a third they work very well in research labs. Now, when it comes to employment, you need to find your match, and you need to understand what they want, and you need to understand what you want. And this might be a difficult thing to do. So, for example, if you're an all-rounder, you know about microcontrollers, about FPGAs, about PCB design, radios, whatever, you know many things. If you put all those things on the CV, you will be judged as, you know what, this guy knows everything and he doesn't know anything. We want a different person. We want somebody who is fixing this problem. Now, there are companies which they want all-rounders because they have, like, you need to bring up complex boards or, I don't know, to debug very complex stuff. But they don't jump on those people. They are kind of, you know, become a little bit weary when they see those very long CVs with many things. So be careful how you write your CV. Now, this is very good on your CV if you are a freelancer, because you will get a lot of jobs from different people. It's like you have a very large net and you're going to catch different type of fish. But it's not so good for a large company, for a large organization where they want specialized people. Now, all the companies, they're going to tell you, oh, we want creative people. That's bullshit. You know what? That's only in theory. Most of the employers, they want people which they are good at something. They stay with the head down and they do their job. Creative people, they are not like this. Creative people, they are usually difficult to handle. They are arrogant. And that's the way it is. This is how the world works. I'm not saying this as a, you know, I've been dealing with creative people. I am myself a creative person, and sometimes I'm very difficult. So I know I'm talking from experience. Managers, the hiring managers, they are usually very, very careful hiring, you know, creative people. Creative people are difficult to handle. Anyway, this is, again, this is from my own experience, what I've seen in all those years. As I said, big companies, they want good people, working people, which they do what they are told. And managers, they love those employees. Now, if you are a creative person, a little bit disorganized, trying to be in, to have a finger in every single project, probably are better off on your own. That would be my advice. Or working for a small company where they need this type of people, you know, which they can bring the product from idea to 80%, and then the manufacturing people, they take over. If you have a good mix of things, probably you are better off. When I say things, I mean skills. You are better off as a consultant or as a freelance. Okay, that's pretty much it. I think this video got too long anyway. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope you extract some good information about what to do with your career. Hardware engineering or electronics engineering, it's a well-paid job. So if you decide to go this path, it's a difficult path, but it's not like programming or computer science where there are cohorts of people doing the same thing. If you are good at electronics, the success will follow you. You don't need to chase the success. It will come after you. Okay, that's it. I hope you enjoyed it, and I shall see you next time.